Thank you. So hi everyone, my name is Melissa Yuli, and as Anna said, I did my PhD here at CMB. And it was fun to listen to Annette right now and all the assignments that you have to do, because I was taking this course 3 years ago myself, and it's really good that you're here, because this was my first like really initial contact to see what's out there and what's behind academia. So I will start by telling you a little bit about the company that I work for right now. We are called QuintilesIMS. And just briefly, I can say that it's a really huge company doing a lot of different things, different sort of segments. We do commercial, marketing, information selling, and real-world evidence. And basically what this all means is that we are trying to help pharma via consulting for pharma companies. We help them to develop better drugs, penetrate the market, formulate strategic response to any competitors they might have, and identify unmet medical needs. And that this last thing that I said, it's actually what real-world evidence is doing, and that's where I am. So real-world evidence, it's really semi-academic. It's totally a bridge between industry and academia, so you don't feel completely outside of the world when you work in this kind of business. And what we do is something called retrospective epidemiological studies. So is anyone here doing epidemiology? Okay, cool. So then you know what kind of studies we are doing. Basically what this means is that we have a large amount of patient data, and we take this data out from medical journals. So you know, every time you go to a doctor, the doctor writes down what you have been using, what your diseases are, and we have a tool, I developed a tool to extract all this data. And we then connect or link this data with the national health registries. So I'm not sure how much this tells you, but living in Sweden gives us a really unique opportunity to follow patients from like time of diagnosis, looking at 10 years before or 10 years after diagnosis, everything they've been through in terms of medications, the comorbidities. You can look at different predictors of outcomes, different treatment patterns, and it's a huge amount of data that we sit on, and a lot of questions can be answered using this. just to give you sort of examples on how this has been used. So there were two big pharma companies, AstraZeneca and GlaxoSmithKline, that came out with asthma and COPD drugs, and these drugs went to clinical trials, they were fine, worked really well in patients, but then 10 years later, doctors and people started to wonder how these drugs are actually performing. And we did this, my company did this huge retrospective study looking at how, when you take these two drugs, what are the outcomes? Because when you're in a clinical trial, everything is controlled. But then when you start taking drugs outside, you maybe take other drugs at the same time, you have different comorbidities. And what we could see is that GlaxoSmithKline's drug was correlated to a lot of adverse events, basically, and this happened many years after. So they were developing pneumonia and infections and osteoporosis and fractures and all kinds of things. And this then led to change of guidelines in Sweden. So now in Sweden, we don't give GlaxoSmithKline drug, we give the AstraZeneca drug. And the other study is about metastatic breast cancer. Now, this is a really aggressive disease, and there are no clear guidelines on how to treat this. And with the types of studies that we do, you can basically group patient characteristics and see, okay, so you have these patients who are young, and they express these different receptors. What drugs work best on them? And you can make these conclusions and actually change guidelines eventually. So it's really cool, very important, and just great to be part of doing such important work. So I can tell you how my path is to get to this business is. So I did the master's in molecular biology, and I had an early interest for pharma. I wanted to do drug development in obesity drugs, but sort of along the way I figured out that these people don't really need drugs, they need psychological help instead, and a lot of these drugs are not really efficient because they you need to target a lot of different pathways in order to get it right, and none of them can actually do that. But then I did a PhD, and I considered staying in academia many, many times because it is a really, really, it's a fun world, and I like the energy, I like the attitude, I like the people working really hard and trying to get places, and they had things in their own hands somehow. But what I didn't like was being in the lab, day in and day out doing experiments and just forgetting about the theory, because I never had the time to read as much as I needed to read and as much as I wanted to read. So I started to wonder how long is this going to take and what am I really enjoying with my PhD? And I started to think about, okay, I like reading, I like formulating things, I like to discuss science. How can I use this? How can I get a job that I could do what I like to do but not do the boring stuff? So I started to do exactly what you're doing right now, taking career courses. This was the first one. And then there is another one called From Science to Business. Do you know about that one? Has anyone taken it? Okay, so it's a really, really cool course. The good thing there is that you get exposed to people from different backgrounds. You have people from Handelshögskolan and from like statistical backgrounds and just basically, yeah. And we had a real problem to deal with. There was a pharma company, a startup basically, who needed the help of formulating a strategic response to a competitor, which is exactly what consulting companies are doing. And just the fact of sitting together with people with different backgrounds was a lot of fun because I could see different angles, different theories, it gave me a lot to think about. And it also made me realize where my place is, that with my knowledge, I can bring in a lot of things to any business actually, because if it's pharma related in one way or another. So I kind of knew that I wanted to be exposed more to what I experienced in this course. And I started to read a lot of pharma news. I'm not sure if you're familiar with this. They're called Fierce Biotech, Fierce Pharma, BioSmart Briefs. So basically you subscribe to these homepages and you get updates about everything that's happening in the pharma world in a nice and structured, easy way. There are ways of digging deeper and reading more about it if you want to. You can listen to radio programs and you find out like all the major players in the pharma world, all the major drugs, which are competitors, which are fighting with each other, and it's really well written and a lot of fun. So I got a postdoc internship through KI Career Services at a company called IMS Health. So before, now we are called QuintilesIMS Health, there were two complementary companies basically doing similar things and we merged and now we can offer more to our clients. And the good thing with the background, with all this pharma reading is that when I started, I knew the names, I knew all the drugs and it was just easy for me not to mix up like, okay, so this company is called like this and I never made those mistakes. And it was just nice to have learned this through a really, really fun and sort of an easy way. And I know that what sort of purpose of this course is to figure out the transferable skills for you to use later on. And before I do that, I'll just tell you briefly what I do at work. So right now I'm a project leader for three projects in different disease areas. So one of them is breast cancer, the other one is in hematology, and the third one is in asthma and COPD. And then I'm also involved in many different other like vaccine and just purely asthma or other types of cancers. So what we do a lot is that we work with Big Pharma. Together with them, we are formulating different objectives. We have a study design, we have a methodology, the way we work. We show this to them, we explain what we can offer. And then together with them, we formulate different objectives and how we are going to do the study. And for this, there's a whole methodology of writing a proposal and a protocol analysis plan. And then when you have all the data, you write the report. And of course, executive summaries, presentations, and I mean, all these things that you see here are very similar to what we do in academia as well. We have a lot of data, we put it together, and then we sort of present it. And what we also do a lot, since we are a bridge between academia and the industry, we work with academia a lot. We recruit key opinion leaders to our studies because we always need a clinician telling us where to look for certain information, how to deal with certain questions. And the good thing there is that a lot of these key opinion leaders are really positive to interact with us and not directly to with the industry, because there is still a lot of mismatch between the academia and industry and a lot of mistrust. But in a way, since everyone in our team most of the people are from KI. With a PhD, it makes it much easier, you know, smoother transition. And another thing that I do a lot right now is also contracting different people and figuring out different legal aspects on how to do a study. There's a certain amount of travel involved as well, because a lot of times when you when we have a new client, they want to meet us face to face, and so we go to basically wherever in the world, because a lot of times our clients sit in headquarters, which are usually in Switzerland or States or England in some cases. So, and also if you have any questions, just feel free to interrupt me anytime and ask. So in order to do all these different steps, I mean, first of all, we do a lot of background reading because it's different disease areas, and a lot of times it's, so we have specialized teams. I'm in the oncology team, and we have vaccine team and metabolism team, but sometimes you also need to step outside of your box and work on different projects, and obviously that requires a lot of background reading. So I spend a lot of time on PubMed, searching the literature and trying to figure out, just get an overview of the theory behind. And this is something that you do every day as well, of course. It's the same thing with the study design and methodology. Prior to any project initiation, you map out different steps. What do I need to do? How do I get there? Which methods do I use to answer my questions? And that really correlates to how I was doing my experiments. I don't just start. I read through protocols and I try to figure out, is this protocol going to answer this particular research question? So then we have a lot of data analysis interpretation as well, which is also very similar to how it is in academia. The good thing in my company is that we have a whole statistician team working with a lot of data, and they do all the data cleaning, data management. And basically what a project manager, what I get is a huge data set of clean data, a lot of times also either in tables or presentations. And then I put it all together. I figure out what it all means, put it in different perspectives, and then write it up in a report. And there it's very important to have the scientific thinking. What does it all mean? How can I use it? How can I communicate this to different people? Because a lot of times you work with people who have a business background. They don't know science like we do. So you need to find ways to make it very real for everyone. And that's a really fun part. Like, this is exactly what I like to do. During my PhD as well, and I even took a course of communicating science in different contexts, which was also very good. we do a lot of presentations as well, and again, that's also to within our own teams, and then also to the client and on the conferences. And one thing that I see is quite different from what I do or how I do things and how people who don't have a PhD or who don't have enough experience is documentation. And like, I mean, we are sitting in our labs and we have to write down everything, because if we don't, then, you know, the experiment is gonna take even longer because we will never remember what we did. So I'm very good in documenting because I've gone through that path trying to figure out what the heck I did like 5 weeks ago or 5 months ago. And I learned that really well, and that helps. It makes it very easy to be more efficient, just knowing where everything is and how everything is structured. So those are the skills that I basically use every day, and I learned them from taking or from doing a PhD. And then another thing that I also definitely can see from people from KI is the energy and drive, and like energy to actually work hard. Like we. Being a PhD student, you are in lab a lot of hours, you do a lot of things, and you don't give up. I mean, you just kind of continue and you do your thing. And this is something that especially consulting world is very keen on. Did you want to ask something?
Yes. So actually, I wanted to ask you, do you have any, no, this actually in economics or business, before starting your
No, actually not at all, but I can tell you that...
How much is that needed, let's say, for something like this? I mean, should we take some basic courses, let's say, in basic economics or finance, or or company management in order to become, let's say, consultants?
Well, I mean, not really, to be honest. It depends. It depends. But no, not really, because maybe this is weird to say, but I think that business is something that is more intuitive to learn than science. It's a lot about business, is a lot about people. So if I think it's just something that comes with time. I feel that I'm learning on the way. What I could use a bit more is epidemiological and statistics. Statistics is really good to know, and because that's something that you can use wherever you are. If you go to investment banking, wherever you go later on, statistics is great. And I feel that in the beginning it was hard for me because I didn't have this background at all. They took me on because I was good in writing, and they could see that in my CV, and I was just lucky that the person reading my CV felt that, okay, finally, I like this way of structuring things, and we had an interview, and she liked me, and it was fine. But it was hard, like, with all the statistical stuff, and I had to learn a lot on the job. But even there, I'm happy that I learned that depth of the job, than, you know, how to think about scientific questions, because it's a skill that you develop throughout many years. And when it comes to business, yeah, it's just gonna come.
So things like you learn.
Yeah. So I can. Yeah. So the thing is, when you work in it, when you. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So the question was like, what? So how did you learn all the analysis, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. So this is another really, really nice thing, because when you work in a big company, you work in different teams. So this is also why, like, I'm learning business on the way, because I have people doing that part of the job. I have statisticians, pure statisticians, doing all the statistical analysis. They do all the data management, all data cleaning. What I get is just the set. I get it all done. And my thing is just to you know, put it all in different perspective. It's the same thing with people. We have a lot of people with business background from all kinds of different, with MBAs. And they are the ones who are selling, they are the ones who are key account managers, they are the ones who, you know, bring in business. So it's different, it's basically different skills that different people have. And it's a lot of sharing as well. Like, I don't, if I'm doing something new, I don't continue doing it if I know that someone else has done it, because we don't have that time. And people are really open. Everyone is all the time sharing, so we can be more efficient, so we can bring the business to the client. So it's a different setup than it is in academia. Here you're expected to do a lot yourself. That's not the case. In at IMS, I have my role, I know what I'm doing, and I ask everyone else for help to do their part. So in that sense, it's great. It's just that for me, it would have been nicer if I knew what these analysis actually meant, and I'm learning on the way. And so it's okay if you don't have it. It's not a requirement in that sense. So yeah, and again, like, project management skills, it's the same thing there. And I feel that a lot of people, I mean, if I compare people coming to us from different backgrounds, I think that, like, everyone who has been at KI, they know how to do project management, because that's what we do all the time as well. We have our 4 papers that we need to publish. We have our first authorships that we need to have. And even though you have a supervisor at KI, it's a lot is up to you. You need to do the actual job. And this is really something that I have with me. I know how to organize stuff, and I know how to prioritize my time and you know, talk to other people, collaborate, all these things I've learned. And it's the same with organizational skills. I mean, I think that I didn't give myself enough credit when I was at KI. I just thought, like, everyone I know has a PhD, everyone I know does the same thing, like, what's the big deal, in a sense? But it's not really like that, because you learn a lot along the way. And another thing that I see with basically everyone who is good at their job, everyone is really, really thorough, and that it doesn't matter if you, whatever background you have. But just the sort of the attitude of not feeling that, oh, you know, this is too simple, or this is not maybe that important. Tackle everything like that, like it's really, really serious, and dig in really deep into things, and, you know, then things will be fine. And I feel that a lot of people from KI who come to us have this attitude and have this just sort of way of working that not everyone has. And that's also something that I learned here, because you have to. You can't. I mean, otherwise it takes forever. If you are not thorough, if you don't have good organizational skills, if you don't have the drive and energy, you'll never finish your PhD. And we actually do finish our PhD eventually. So it's you come out like as a nice package in a sense. And it was great seeing that as well, that I can contribute so much to a company that is doing different things. Like I have my place there, and it's definitely nice. But then I also want to talk a little bit about certain problems with being too academic, because this is definitely something that we see as well, and I was one of them too. It's the perfectionism and really hard of letting things go. Like I could sit with my, first of all, sitting with your text alone in the company doesn't work because you need to share. We have everything on the same drive, and like when you write something, you put it on there so other people can go and look at what you have done so they don't have to do the same thing or change or whatever. But I was sitting with the text really long time, and then people are like, but you have to let it go. You can't just wait until it's perfect. It doesn't work like that. But for me, it was so hard to let other people read unless I was happy. And we even have a saying that it's like good enough. If it's good enough, let it go. It's going to be fine. you don't have to spend too much time. And it's also because we have too many projects, too many deadlines. And our whole business is really defined according to we need to meet all the project milestones and we need to meet all the deadlines in order to get payments. So it's really like streamline in that sense, so you don't have time to be sort of in your own world like you are in academia. In the academia, you have that time to really dig down and it's maybe contradictive. Like you need to be thorough. Yeah, you need to be thorough and you need to be have a good quality on what you do. But at the same time, the perfectionism is sort of thing to let go as well. And another thing that I also had a bit of a hard time was undefined deadlines, because again, like and when you do a PhD, it's all up to you. You can do basically whatever you want. And in this business, it's not really like that. You need to be good at following different deadlines and just, yeah. So I know that you guys are gonna apply for different internships in this course. So for us, an ideal candidate obviously would be someone with epidemiology, because then you can basically put this person in business really quickly, and they will know the terminology, they will know everything. But this was not my background at all, so it's not a requirement in any sense. One thing that is good is to know how to write, know how to formulate. That's really important. But just sort of like driven problem solver and this sort of yes attitude. And this is really nice at IMS, because people are extremely positive. I don't know how you feel at your work, but like everyone likes what they do a lot. And you can feel that. Everyone feels that it's important. Everyone wants to share information. And it's just sort of like, since we are, I'm not sure if this is driven by the fact that we get money for what we do, but in a sense, it's also like we want to bring in more business and we want everyone else to perform good. So then if someone needs help, I help them, because I know that this is good for the whole company in a way, or for the whole real world evidence at least. So people are really, really helpful, and it's just a positive environment and fun to be there. And this business oriented, like you don't need to have an MBA. It's just a good thing to have social skills that are required to basically get people to do business with you. That's because business is really all about psychology more than anything else, at least how I feel and see about it. So don't get discouraged from applying if you don't have the right set of skills, because again, it's a big company with a lot of different backgrounds. We have even people from that don't have a PhD, but they have done bioentrepreneurship program in at KI, and are now working in different parts. I think that real world evidence, there most of people have a PhD, but like in other places, they don't. There's a commercial. There are all kinds of different things that one can do. And also when you are in the company, move to different departments, and so it's kind of fun. So I just want to leave with that you ask yourself what you enjoy most and how you can use that. How can you find a job where you can do what you actually like and not have to do as much as what you know? Do you have any questions?
Yeah. I wanted to ask, what do you think the workload regarding the working hours, the and compared to PhD, but maybe not necessarily lab work?
Well, I can say that, sorry, I have to repeat the question. The question was about the workload and how much we spend time at work, and then also how that compares to academia. I think that any consultancy business, it's a lot of work, basically, but I can say, like, okay, I work maybe normal hours during the day and a lot of the evenings and some of the weekends. So it's quite a lot. At the same time, I think that when you come to a certain level, it's not really like that. And it also goes very much in different periods. Like sometimes it's very high intense and then it's basically a lot. And then sometimes, I mean, I can come here and you know, give a talk and I can go and see my kids. I mean, it's fine. It's okay. It's not really that I'm drawing in work, but I maybe also feel this way because I like it so much. I think it's really fun. So the thing is that when my kids go to bed in the evening, I take up my laptop and I do these things that don't really require that much thinking, but like because I'm tired, so I'm writing emails and I'm organizing meetings and I'm doing things that need to be done, but I don't have time to do them during the day. So, but I like what I'm doing, so it's maybe not, it doesn't feel as much, I would say. Yeah?
But if you're comparing to McKinsey, for example, like do your companies that, or I don't know about, I think it's a bit bigger.
Yeah, McKinsey is a bigger consulting company because they are focused, so we are not focused only on consulting, and McKinsey is. And if I compare with McKinsey, it's much worse, because, at McKinsey, I mean, because there the thing is that you need to be with the client Monday to Thursday, and then you are at, this is the same for McKinsey and BCG, and then...
Yeah, but I had a friend who was working there, and he said it was very, the interview already is like 4 rounds, and it's very... evaluating, so you cannot really perform. It's more about like writing down what you did and evaluating if you're the right person or the right, if you developed enough in the company. And that he really didn't like and was a bit unsure, and then he also stopped working there.
Yeah, okay.
So do you think it's the same in your company?
So I didn't really understand. So he felt that he was undeveloped, that they were not developing him as a person, or that.
They had some meetings every week, and he had to write down what he learned in this week and how he developed his skills and so on. So
well, we have development plans, but it's not really like that. For us, it's all about, you know, delivering good quality studies to the client, basically, and it's not in that way at all. We don't need to evaluate ourselves every week. We evaluate ourselves twice per year, and that's, you know, to get your promotions and increases in salary and. Things like that, but it's not like that at all. And the workload is not the same either. I know that people at McKinsey are supposed to work around 60, 70 hours at least a week. So that's probably quite a lot. And I think that, I'm not sure what the average is. I think this was like the lower limit. But I think like maybe, I don't know what to say. I see people who are levels above me and they don't work as much as I still need to work hard because I don't know the business as well, so I need to do it. And I think that it's going to get easier later on. And I'm also really bad in saying no to different projects because it's, again, I just want to excel. So it's a little bit up to me as well. And I know that a lot of people are staying on the same level for a long time. You can do that. You don't have to want to go to the next step. And if you don't want that, then you can be on that level for a while. And it's a great level to be at. It's not it's not bad. It's just that I want to like take the next step. So then I work harder. But that's, yeah.
Yeah, so I was just curious, what are the steps?
Yeah, so basically the entry level is a business analyst. That's where I am right now. And then you come to consultant. And I'm now transitioning to become a consultant because I'm getting, so basically as a business analyst, you don't manage your own project, you are helping out with different projects, and this is really important to do because that's how you learn the business. But now I'm leading 3-year projects, so it's you're also supposed to operate on that level for a while before you get promoted. After consultant, you basically land in that role and you are driving all the projects, and from 3, you probably have 6 or something. From that level, it's a senior consultant. What you do then is then you bring in a lot of business. I mean, you do that already as a consultant because every time you deliver a project, you, with the skills that you have, you figure out different questions that the company might want to get an answer on. And a lot of times it really works because it's all about science. And it's really exciting to be with these people and like, oh, maybe we could do it like this and maybe we want to know that. And then you kind of subconsciously sell more business because selling is not my strength at all. And apparently I'm doing it all the time because this is how it's a natural progress. But as a senior consultant, then you sell more. I mean, you are supposed to bring in a lot of different companies, basically. And then from there, you also have some people management. Engagement manager is a step above, and then you have a lot of people that you need to sort of supervise and help and things like that. And then principal, senior principal, president, and so on. I think there was a question up there.
Yeah, so I have some questions, but I would like to start, now that you mentioned this business analyst consultant, how long does it take to go through those stages?
Exactly, so so the question was, how long does it take to go from one level to the second level? It's supposed to take between 1.5 and 3 years, so depending on where you are, basically. Sometimes faster, sometimes slower. We have a girl who started as an analyst, but she had like 4 years of postdoc experience, and I mean, she and the right background, so she got promoted within a year. So it can happen before as well, but typically, like, it's 2 years, 3 years, or something.
And then the more you progress in this stair, the more busy you are, or how is that?
Well, yeah, I think up to consultant level, you're really busy. As a senior consultant, you're really busy too. Step above that, you're not as busy maybe because you are pretty busy actually. I don't want to sugarcoat it. Like it's a consultancy business. It's a lot of work. But again, like I really don't see it that way. It's not like the thing is like this. I felt that I was working much harder at KI, and why? Because I did all these experiments that gave me nothing really, and I never answered my questions. Or I had the question 1 year, and then 4 years later, oh, here's my answer, and I forgot what I was wondering about in the first place. So then I felt that I wasted my time, and also I felt that no one really. I mean, it was more my thing. Like people didn't really care as much about it. So then those are the things that made me feel that I work hard. And I worked less hours at KI for sure, but I felt that I worked more than I work now.
And then one last question. Do you miss something from academia, if you do? And second one, what is the best part and the worst part from being a consultant or working right now as you are?
So if I miss something with academia, to be honest, I interact so much with academia nowadays, all the time, because so our projects are set up in a way that we have key opinion leaders, which are always clinicians and professors, and the pharma companies. So I am a lot with academia all the time. So no, I don't really miss it because I get to do the theory and nothing boring. And the second question, what's the best thing? The best thing is that really the network that I developed is great because like you immediately, I mean, if you go to a pharma company, you have all these different steps that you go through. When you are in a consultancy, you meet with the biggest people in the pharma, like it's global directors and everyone on these high positions because they are the ones who are driving the studies. And being around these people is amazing, really, because they have a lot of experience, they have super lot of knowledge, great questions, and they also have a lot of money. Pharma has a lot of money to do all the great studies that we want to do. I never feel restricted. It's always like, wow, okay, so we can do this and we can do that. Well, that's amazing, really. So that's the best part, that we can do so much with the data that we have. And the outcomes, like things that we do change guidelines. It's really cool. It feels very important. And that's the thing that I felt that I like from academia, that I never felt important, my job never felt important, and that's the biggest difference. And the worst part in where I am now, was that the question? I don't know, like I can't tell you anything, I don't see anything negative. I've been there now for a bit more than a year. I started in November 2015. And I love it. So,
yeah. So your job is based here in Stockholm, right?
Yeah. We are actually in Solna.
How much you communicate in Swedish, or is it made in English?
Yeah. So, do I need to repeat this question as well? Okay, yeah. So the question was how much Swedish people need to know at the company. So basically, it's an international company, and a lot of times, I mean, more than 50% of your time, you are talking with clients who are based all over the world. But it's very good to speak Swedish because when we do our studies, we need to find out a lot of things from the government, for example. And they are usually in Swedish, so it's always nice to have that. But it's not a requirement either. We have tons of people who don't speak Swedish or who are kind of okay with speaking Swedish, and they are, at least they're okay with using Google Translator and then sort of figuring out what to do. We write a lot of ethical permits as well, so it's of course nice to, but again, it's not a requirement. Any more questions? Yeah.
I just wanted to ask you, how much are you going to communicate with your customers? I mean, is it actually on a daily basis? Is it maybe a week?
Project? No. So this is the thing because. I mean, at the analyst level, you don't talk so much with clients, but I'm now transitioning to the next level, and I've been doing that for quite a while. So I have a lot of contact with clients basically every day. It's either emails or telephone conferences or face-to-face. Tomorrow I'm going to London, for example, to meet a new client. So it's a lot. I mean, for me, it's a lot right now.
Or us to contact you in case we have questions.
We can add them in, that's totally fine.
And then I just wanted you to make a comment because you said for we should actually avoid being perfectionists in this job.
Maybe not now, but later.
Exactly. But actually, I've got it by my colleagues who are also consultants for you. Actually, they pay a lot of attention to the deal. So I'm like, they've told me that, they look after pixel after pixel in some big.
Yeah, some clients do that. We have definitely had some.
BCG. So I think that it is mostly details.
I mean, it all depends. So the question was about perfectionism and how perfect you have to be in your job. Like it's a really. Depends on where you put the level, I think. If you ask me what's perfect, if you ask someone else what's perfect, everyone is going to give you a different question. Of course, when you deliver something to the client, it has to look good. It has to have a good structure. It has to have no spelling mistakes. It has to be, it has to look very nice and professional. But the thing is one of the things that we always do is that we have QC, quality control. So before I send anything to my client, I have people in my team reading what I've done before I send it away. But it was more that, this example that I said, that I was sitting with my text for, days instead of just giving it away to someone. These are the kinds of things that you should ask for help a little bit more. Maybe it still has to be good quality when you deliver, but maybe the way to get there can be a little bit different than it is in academia, because in academia you are quite alone. Here you're not alone. You should use your colleagues to help you to deliver the best possible quality to the client, because the client is who matters. Not what the what your colleague is going to think about you. Doesn't matter. So, any other questions? Yeah.
Have you done a postdoc?
No, I never did a postdoc. And a lot of people have done it, and I didn't. I think that when you do a PhD, you have a lot of project management skills anyway. Did you want to say something?
You did a short course.
Sorry, I did it. Well, okay. So this is the. I was quite lucky actually because. So what happened was that I took this course, and then I wanted to do an internship, but then I got pregnant and I wanted to finish my thesis. So then I didn't take any internships at that time, But then when I was on maternity leave, I contacted you guys, and I was allowed to take an internship then. So I kind of took a postdoc internship, even though I wasn't a postdoc. And this was great because it gave me 2 months instead of 1 month. So it really worked out perfectly that it happened that way. So then I was at IMS for those 2 months. But no, like in practical, I didn't do it in postdoc. And I didn't really want to either. Yeah. Yeah.
How much? So in your okay. How would do you say that plenty of people actually working in Alberta, they've done postdocs or not? I mean, do they tend to hire people directly after masters or PhDs, or
yeah, so I think that this question is good because it's really like this was an internal question when I was here as well. Like, do you need to do a postdoc? Is it important for the pharma industry? Well, the only thing that I can say is that people who not really. It's not a requirement much, but it gives you more scientific credibility in a way. So yeah, it's not a bad thing if you're done a postdoc. We have a lot of people who don't have a postdoc. We have even more people who do have a postdoc. Differences between us are maybe not that big, but it is somewhat bigger in the publication record. And it's just nice to have more academic things behind you in a way. So, I mean, I didn't do it and I didn't want to do it and I'm happy that I didn't, but like if you do a postdoc and you publish a bunch of things, that's obviously going to be a nice thing. For pharma and for consulting. It just looks good. But like I don't have that many publications and it was fine. So yeah.
So maybe that's we say thank you to Melissa.
Yeah.
And
thank you.